Good morning, and I want to welcome each one of you that has already gathered here this morning as we continue in our worship service in this place that's very special and dear to us. I also want to say a special greeting to somebody that we can't see, but they can see us. Because for the first time this morning, we're attempting to stream this service live. What does stream mean? It means that if you have an internet at home, you can go through, I think it's Facebook, and then come on and connect to the service. Now, we've already been filming our last two Sundays, and they are on our church's webpage. And Pam Longhurst was really delighted that she was able to see the service. And I told her, we're going to try this morning. It may not work, but she already may be tuned in and it may be working. And so we want to say,
She was having trouble, and she phoned up and contacted the people who know.
Oh.
And they've made contact with her. So Pam is actually in now.
Good. So Pam, we all of us send you our warmest greetings, and we welcome that you can be with us on your laptop or home computer or however you have it set up at that end. And this is a wonderful thing that we can share in this way with those who may not be able to come. I was just at a conference yesterday, and another advantage of this is to have it streamed live. And that is, when we have special service and we invite people in the neighborhood, one good thing to know is to let them know you can see this service at home. Many people may be a bit shy about coming to church for the first time, but with that notice, I can look at it at home, and if it's good, I can keep watching it. If I get bored, I can turn it off and don't disturb anybody there. There's also a fear of entering a building for the first time. And so this is a wonderful tool to reach the community. People have already said it was easier to walk into this building because we had pictures of our inside our sanctuary on our webpage. And so I hope that this will be another aid as we try to witness to our community. So to all of you, both present and afar, we welcome you this morning as we come to worship this morning. I often pick a short verses of scripture to read responsively. And one verse that is amongst my very favorite is the closing verses of Isaiah, the prophet Isaiah. If you like this passage, just go to chapter 40 at home and look at the last few verses, and you caught it up here. So may we read responsively and be reminded of this wonderful truth and find encouragement in God's word as we gather to worship him this morning. Let's read responsively. I'll read the verses in light print and ask the congregation to read the verses in bold print. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth.
He will not grow tired or weary. His understanding never runs dry.
He gives strength to the weary and increases the power of the weak.
Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall.
But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength.
They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint.
Amen. May we pray. Oh, Father, we gather this morning, and we want to be still and know that you are God. Father, we know that you are here. Father, we know that you are present. Father, forgive us when we are overwhelmed by our concerns, our worries, or even overwhelmed by our joys, that we fail to pause and to thank you for the good blessings, and to pause not only to ask you for help in our troubles and our concerns, but also to listen to you and have you minister to us in our need. Father, we know that your presence by the presence of your Holy Spirit. We know that you desire that we worship you in spirit and in truth. And so come, Holy Spirit, empower us, energize us, even in this act of worship. Father, you know our hearts, search our hearts, and know our every thought. Father, we confess to you our sins and our shortcomings with the confidence that as we confess our sins, you will forgive us and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. For our precious Lord Jesus Christ has been that ransom. He's been that atoning sacrifice that wipes us clean so a just God can say, you are forgiven. Father, may we experience your presence. May we experience your love. May we experience your forgiveness. May we experience your grace. And I pray, Father, you give us a fresh glimpse of your glory as we worship this morning. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Would you like to be part of the choir this morning? Some groups is meeting after the service to be it, but I'm going to get everybody that's present this morning a chance to be sing with our choir. The choir is going to sing first one of my very favorite anthems in our collection. One of my favorite composers is Franz Schubert, and this is his composition, Holy, Holy, Holy. And after the choir sings through it, Carolyn's going to direct us. And after the choir sings through it, she's going to turn around, and the congregation is going to be joining us. And in your hymn books, that is hymn number 457. So I'd ask the congregation to use our Baptist praise and worship, have the words open to 457. And when Carolyn turns around and asks you to stand, be ready as she leads us as we sing after the choir. Choir sings.
Praise to you. and wonder, circling round the throne. Praise Him, Holy Spirit, Lord of life alone. Glory to the Father, glory to the Son, and the Holy Spirit, ever three. Glory to the Son and the Holy Spirit, ever three in one.
Thank you. As we still standing, let's continue standing, and in our hymn books, turn to another glorious hymn, hymn number 29, All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name, hymn number 29, and we're going to sing verses 1, 3, 5, and 7, 6, 1, 3, 5, and 6.
Let angels prostrate fall. Lift up the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. You said of Israel's chosen race, a remnant weak and small, a remnant sweet and small. Hail him who says you by His grace, and crown him, and crown Him Lord of all. Let every kindred, every tribe, on this terrestrial ball, on this terrestrial ball, to Him all majesty ascribe, and crown him Lord of all. Oh, that with yonder sacred throne we at His feet may fall, we at His feet may fall, join in the everlasting song. and crown him Lord of all.
This next chorus that we do is not in our hymn books, but you'll find the words on the screen. As we talk about waiting upon the Lord, and this one, strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord, as we wait upon the Lord, as we wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God. God, you do not fade, you won't grow weary. You are the ever of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up like wings on eagles. You rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the God, the everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the every fender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like
this time of worship by singing a soft song. Make it a prayer. Jesus, we enthrone you. After declaiming his majesty, the strength that we receive as we wait upon him, let's invite him in that he may take his rightful place in our lives. Jesus, we enthrone you. Number 52 in our collections. I think the words will also be behind us. 52.
Throne you.
Today's scripture reading is taken from Haggai chapter 2, verses 2 to 9. Speak to Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, to Joshua, son of Jehozadak, the high priest, and to the remnant of the people. Ask them, who of you is left who saw this house in its former glory? How does it look to you now? Does it not seem to you like nothing? But now be strong, O Zerubbabel, declares the Lord. Be strong, O Joshua, son of Jehozadak, the high priest. Be strong, all you people of the land, declares the Lord, and work. For I am with you, declares the Lord Almighty. This is what the covenanted with you when you came out of Egypt, and my spirit remains among you. Do not fear. This is what the Lord Almighty says. In a little while, I will once more shake the heavens and the earth, the sea and the dry land. I will shake all nations, and the desire of all nations will come. And I will fill this house with glory, says the Lord Almighty. The silver is mine and the gold is mine, declares the Lord Almighty. The glory of this present house will be greater than the glory of the former house, says the Lord Almighty. And in this place I will grant peace, declares Lord Almighty. Let's pray. Our loving, merciful, and gracious Heavenly Father, we thank Thee for giving us another day in our life to worship You, to praise You, and to acknowledge Your greatness. Lord, we thank Thee for the Bible and the message of Prophet Haggai, sent by You in ancient days. Thank You, Lord, for the encouragement and hope You have given to Your people after delivering them from the bondage of Egypt. Lord, today we claim the same promise that You will fulfill us with encouragement, and Your hope will be our strength. Heavenly Father, we praise You, O God, for all that we see of You in the work of creation, the earth, the sea, sky, and everything that has breath. You are worthy to be praised. Lord, though we are not worthy to be called Yours and Your child, and yet we give You thanks that You love us and gave Your only Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us. Lord Jesus, I thank You for all of Your faithfulness to each one of us who worship You in this place. Lord, we thank Thee for our Pastor Tom. Bless his ministry. We ask for the special leading of the Holy Spirit as he continues to serve You. Lord, I also lift up elders and deacons unto You of our church. Fill them with Your Spirit and let them to operate in wisdom as they carry out Your responsibilities. Lord, we thank Thee for the lovely choir. Let the echoes of the praise reach to Your heavens. Lord, we pray for the children and youth. Let them grow stronger in faith and pursue righteousness so that they can declare Your marvelous deeds for the future generation. Lord, we ask for your grace and salvation for the people in Watford and across the country. We also pray for our leaders and politicians. Grant them the wisdom to lead this country forward in peace and prosperity. Especially, Lord, we ask for the mercies and tender loving care towards the children of Yemen's war, children who are on the brink of famine. Rescue them from the hands of ISIS. Have mercy, O God, on these defenseless people in terrible zones of war. Heavenly Father, we entrust to your love and your care. Lord, we entrust your love towards members of our church families. Supply their needs and guide their steps. Lord, we pray for the sickness amongst our church members and families. Touch and heal them. Grant them complete recovery. We also ask for your blessings, those who are visiting us today. Heavenly Father, we surrender this morning unto thy hands. Open our spirit to understand your word. You know each one of us by name, and we are dependent on you. We love you, Lord, and offer this prayer in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Continuing the spirit of worship and praise, may we sing hymn number 57, Majesty, Worship His Majesty. Number 57, and the words may also appear on the screen. To you from that which you have given to us. We recognize you as the giver of all good and perfect gifts. And as we come to worship, we come to give as well. Father, I pray that you give us wisdom, that we may administer these resources in a way that would honor your name and
and contribute to the advancement of your kingdom and your honor and your glory on this earth. For it is in the precious name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated, and the youth will leave to their Sunday school at this time, and the children will go as well to their classes at this time. Thank you for the teachers who will be leaving with our children or our young people. As you come to reflect upon the reading that was made earlier from the book of Haggai, we pause and seek the teaching from God by His Spirit to speak to our hearts this morning. May we pray. Holy Father, as we come to open your word, to reflect upon it, we claim the promise given to us by our Lord Jesus Christ. He told us that He would send us His Spirit and guide us into all truth. And so I pray, Father, that Your Spirit would open Your eyes that we may see with insight. Father, open our ears that we may hear with understanding. But also, Father, I pray that we may offer You a humble and a contrite heart. Father, keep us from the sin of being stiff-necked and hard-hearted, the temptation of being hearers and not doers of Your word. But Father, we long to be like clay in Your hands, in the potter's hands, that You may continue to remake us and remold us after Your will. And so, Father, I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart may be pleasing and acceptable in Your sight. Hide me behind the cross of Jesus Christ. And may Christ be high and lifted up. For I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. About a couple of weeks ago, I read this passage through again in Haggai. And as I read it, it stirred my heart. And I felt so many parallels between the situation that Haggai was addressing to the people after they had spent 7 years in exile in Babylonian and come back to Jerusalem and started rebuilding the temple. And they were disheartened. They needed encouragement. They needed energy and a vision to carry on the work that had been asked of them of rebuilding that temple and restoring the worship in Jerusalem. And as I read that, and I just resonated with our situation here in Watford. They needed encouragement back then amidst the seemingly insurmountable odds. Can you think of a greater contrast of building that temple? You see, because when Solomon built that temple, it had been the desire of his father, King David, to build it. And for several decades, a couple of decades, he started to collect the building supplies, the great treasuries, the rocks, the wood, all the resources for the building of the temple. And that was at the height of the power of the country of King David. And then he passed on the reign. He wanted to build it, but because he had so much blood on his hand, that the joy of building it was entrusted to Solomon, his son. And Solomon came and was a special gift of wisdom.
He was a peacemaker, where David had been constantly engaged in military campaigns and victories. Solomon had a reign of peace, and he had made alliances with the surrounding countries, the powers that remained, and enjoyed peace, administered that great big wealth, and again, at the height of the wealth of that country, that temple was built. Can you imagine a greater contrast now with these exiles who return without the military power, without the military might, without all the wealth that King David and Solomon had together amassed to build this temple? And they were asked to build it. You know, they were in exiles for 7 years. Some of those people came back to Jerusalem already in their mid-70s. Would have remembered the glory of the former temple. Even those that didn't see the temple, that were in exile during all their lives, just come to Jerusalem, I'm sure they could have seen the foundation stones. They could have made out what the temple used to be. And what they were building was so much smaller and humbler than the magnificent temple that Solomon had built in the height of their power and affluence. They were discouraged. They needed words of encouragement. And if we're honest with ourselves, how often do we hear at Beechen Grove Baptist Church need encouragement? Look around you this morning. We normally don't do this, but I asked Alan to count. How many do we have now?
43.
We have 43 people present in our sanctuary this morning. There are 30 pews. So we're less than two persons per pew. And as some of you are sitting on three and four bread, we have a number of empty pews. And this was a good number 5.5 years ago. Often we had in the low 20s here, less than a person in pew. God's blessing us. We are encouraged. We are encouraged. We're grateful to God that He's adding to our number. But let's be honest, it's a slow process, isn't it? Sometimes we still look at these pews and also remember when these people remembered the glory of former times. The building itself reminds us of the former glory of this temple and the crowds that used to gather. Alan has put some pictures out on some of our anniversaries, and there's a glorious picture, it's only a picture now, of the former glory of this temple. Before this ceiling was here, with a great big gallery, I imagine it would seat about 800 people. The pews came forward here, the pews went halfway back into the oasis. You had all that room. And back when it was built, there were times when it was full, completely full. And many of you remember great days of greater glory. And you come here and you rejoice at what God is doing here, but you're also in that tension. We've been stronger in the past. We need encouragement. And so let's look at that. Can we see the parallels? Does Haggai have a word for us and not him? Does Haggai speak a word of the Lord for us? And this is the key message that he does. The key message is, but now be strong. Be strong. Twice he says that in the opening verse. But now be strong, be strong. I'm going to skip over the people that he addressed. He says, be strong and work. Be strong and work. There's a task before us. And then comes that wonderful promise, be strong and work, for I am with you, and my spirit remains with you. I'll just go this, what causes discouragement to us today? It's not just the empty pews. We're so grateful that God is adding to our number. Let's be honest. It still might be slow, isn't it? We still long to see God doing something wonderful here. But there's also a bigger background and more pressing matters than just a building that's so far from being filled. And that's a commission that God has given us. God told his disciples, or Jesus told his disciples, and he tells us to go and make disciples of all peoples, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and teaching to observe all I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always. When Jesus called his disciples, he says, follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. Or the greater yearning is not just to fill this building. The greater yearning should be that we be effective disciple makers. That God uses us to introduce other people to the wonderful joy of knowing Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior. That should be the greatest yearning, even more than the number of people that we're able to gather here. There are also some very haunting parables. Several of them. I'm just going to read one of them. And that's from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 13, in our Pew Bibles. I think it's number 1046, if you want to follow it. But it's from Luke, chapter 13. I'm reading verse 6 to 9. Then Jesus told this parable. A man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard, and he went to look for fruit on it, but did not find any. So he said to the man who took care of the vineyard, for 3 years now, I've been coming to look for fruit on this fig tree and haven't found any. Cut it down. Why should it use up the soil? Sir, the man replied, leave it alone for one more year, and I'll dig around it and fertilize it. If it bears fruit next year, fine. If not, then cut it down. You feel the challenge of this parable. The one who calls us comes looking for fruits. Part of the prayer, that the model of prayer that he gave us is, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. And the kingdom is not a geographical area, it's the lordship of Jesus Christ. And that lordship is expressed as we forever yield more of our lives to Christ, to his lordship, and mold our lives after his will for our lives. But also we're to bear fruit. We're to be instruments in God's hands for the advancement of his kingdom, that others may come under the lordship of Jesus Christ. Oh, how we need to pray that God will make us effective in disciple making, introducing our friends, family, neighbors to the lordship of Jesus, and let them be overcome by the wondrous love of our Savior Jesus Christ. Where is encouragement? Where do we find this encouragement? There's something I think that in the context we need to see that's also should give us encouragement today. Notice as he addresses in verse 4, he first of all speaks to Zerubbabel. Zerubbabel was a Jewish. He came with the exiles back into Jerusalem. But he had authority. He was the governor. He was responsible still for the power of the East. But he was governing. He had a lot of authority. And he was a man after God. And then there was the high priest. The high priest was Joshua, son of Josedek, a godly man too, who embraced the challenging times. And then it was addressed to all the people of the land. Who does God address today? Who's included in this word of encouragement? You know, we need to pause and be grateful to God for the rulers that we have today, the authorities in our country. In 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1-2, we're told to pray for those in authority. And how delighted we must be that this country has the queen that we have now on the throne. I've been here a number of years, and I've been a part of a family that sits down on Christmas Day and listens to the queen's speech. What marvelous testimony has the queen given to this country? We need to be praying for her and grateful. This encouragement is through her. How about our prime minister? It may not be your political party. Maybe some of the policies you have difficulties with. But I hope we can recognize a person of integrity. A person that's grew up in the Christian home with so many Christian values. How fortunate we are to have the prime minister we have today. How fortunate we are here in Watford to have Dorothy Thornhill as the mayor of our town. Those in authority, those words are addressed to those in authority. How grateful we can be. God's favor is upon us. There's a wonderful window of opportunity for us. How about the high priest? I hope you can look beyond the Baptist circles. Hope you can rejoice at the new archbishop, well, not new, so new now, Archbishop of Canterbury, Justin Welby. What a man of God. What a man for our day. I hope you can look at the high priest and look beyond our immediate circles and see in the Pope that's now in Rome, Pope Francis. What a very special person he is for that role. We live in a time of God's favor, where God is moving. So he speaks to the governors, those in civil authorities. He speaks to those high priests, those in religious authority. And then he also speaks to the people of the land. He speaks to those who are listening. And I know that a smaller percent of our population here in England is in church now Sundays, seeking to listen and to worship God. Others may be doing it in their homes and other places, but it's still a small percentage. But the word is addressed to you. And the word is also addressed of hope of those who aren't listening. God calls his rain to fall on the just and the unjust. The word is for all of us, all the people of the land. And what's his words of encouragement? First of all, I would say we should be encouraged from the promise of his presence. In Haggai 2:4, it says, I am with you. I am with you. Have you seen how often that theme is, both of the Old Testament and the New Testament? I love the book of Joshua. In Joshua chapter 1, several times it says, be strong and courageous. And then it says, "For I will never leave you or forsake you. Joshua had an incredible task before him. And the encouraging words that God gave him, I am with you. I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. When our Lord Jesus gave the great commission to his disciples, go and make disciples of all nations. After giving them that great task, what did he say as an encouragement? And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. This is a source of encouragement. We're not on this alone. I love one time one of the prophets of the Old Testament, the invading army found out that he was telling the king of Israel movements of this mighty military force that was attacking Israel. And then they find out, I've got somebody, one of my generals must be a spy and telling them where we are. And one of the soldiers says, no, it's not one of us. There's a prophet in the land that tells the king your movements. And so the king sent a contingent of his army in this tiny little unwalled village. And when the prophet's servant woke up the next morning, they were surrounded. Unwalled village, surrounded by these mighty troops. And the servant came to the prophet trembling. He says, look, we're doomed. Look at the numbers that are out there against us. And the prophet says, those who are with us are greater than those who are against us. Those who are with us, and the one supreme one who's with us, is our God himself. Lo, I am with you always. We should find encouragement in his promise, in his presence. He's given us a great task, but he's not left us alone. But also, we should find encouragement in his promises. Encouragement in his promises. In verse 5 of Haggai 2, and my spirit remains amongst you. My spirit remains amongst you. Also in the book of Acts, when he's giving the commission in another way to the disciples, he says, and you shall wait in Jerusalem until the Spirit comes upon you, and you will be endued with power, and you'll be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria, and to the uttermost parts of the world. God has promised his Spirit remains with us. And he says, I will fill this house with my glory. Here he says the glory of the future house will be even greater than the glory of the past. Can you believe that? If you do, if you're good at mathematics, it says it's taken us 5 years to grow this much. How long will it be? Well, I think God's going to do things a little bit different than we may expect it. He's already doing something wonderful. If seeing this place filled with people, come here between 6 and 8 Sunday evenings. You find this organ moved right against these doors because a 26-piece brass band sits here. The choir is completely full. They move those pews right up to the edge and put more chairs, and they're overflowing. The sanctuary, you'll have women on this side and men on this side. The doors of the oasis, the sliding doors will be open. There'll be people all the way to the back. And then there'll be two large rooms full of children. God is already moving. The glory may look different from the past. They're not worshiping in English. If you come, you won't understand it because they're worshiping in Romanian. And then there are some smaller groups that are smaller in number, but they're even louder. There's a lovely group that worships in the Tree dialect, most of these from Ghana and surrounding regions. And they're a small group, but they're even louder than the big group. They worship the Lord with great joy and exuberance. And other groups are worshiping in Portuguese, worshiping in English with a very West Indies accent. The glory of the Lord is in this place. Look at what he's doing. But there's a hymn that we used to sing when growing up, while others thou art calling, do not pass me by. I don't believe God is going to pass us by at Beechen Grove Baptist Church. As he's blessing others, he will certainly bless us. In verse 8 he says, the silver and gold is mine. Don't be preoccupied with finances. The cattle on 1,000 hills are his, says the psalmist. Abigail and I have been amazed these past few months at the amount of money that God is entrusting to us. Our bank balance keeps going up month after month after month. Last 3 months, What a responsibility is ours to administer this in a way that will bring honor and glory to the Lord. Here we see, the silver and the gold is mine. And he's blessing us with this. And then he says the wonderful verse 9, and in this place I will grant peace. In this place I will grant peace. This will be a place where people enter and experience the peace of our God. And his kingdom expand. That's the promise. In this place I will grant peace. So I want us to be encouraged. There's another little prophet. I want to close with this from Habakkuk chapter 2. And here we read, for the revelation awaits an appointed time. It speaks of the end and will not prove false. Though it linger, wait for it. It will certainly come and will not delay. Though it linger, wait for it. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. And as that chorus that we sang at the beginning of the service, strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we depend upon the Lord. Faith will rise as we trust upon the Lord. May we see a glorious movement of His Spirit. May we gain a fresh glimpse of His glory. May we see the advance of His kingdom and of His honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. In closing our hymn, we're going to sing hymn number 375. 375. This hymn was also written in a very challenging time. This was one of Luther's, the great reformist, the Reformation. And he wrote it at a time when the opposition seemed so fierce. And then he penned this hymn. We're not going to sing all verses, but 475. No, sorry, it's 375, not 475, sorry. 375. I was wondering about that. Words were different. 375. We're going to sing verses 1, 2, and 4. 1, 2, no, sorry. 1, 3, and 4. 1, 3, and 4. My choir director gave me instructions. 1, 3, and 4 of hymn 375. If you're able to, may we stand and that we find our strength as we wait upon the Lord. Thank you.
to share with the congregation a blessing to bless the congregation. And then I want us to serve as priests and bless each other by saying the grace together. And then we're even going to have a choral blessing today. But I thank you for your presence today. And I just want to say special joy to have Santosh and Padma here. And I believe that Santosh's parents is with them too today. They moved to Basildon. Is that the name of the town? And anyway, they've even traveled further than Elizabeth. Elizabeth has normally the longest trip, but I believe Basildon is even further away. So you've been outdone today in distance. But we welcome you. So good to have you in our midst, and your parents too, Santosh. For all of you, receive this blessing. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen. May we say the grace to one another. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen.